hand, if you can hear me, and put and close your mouth. All right, let's do it again. Raise your hand and close your mouth if you can hear me. That works pretty good, huh? Cool. All right, great. So we're going to kick off VC 301, an AMA with venture capitalists. We have three VCs up here, and we will let them introduce themselves. We're going to kick off with two intro questions, and then we're going to hand it off to you. I'm Natty from Matchstick Ventures. We're a seed fund based in Colorado and Minnesota, investing in pre-seed and seed stage companies, $1 million first check, anything software related. You can find us at matchstick.vc, but it's not about me up here. I'll hand it off. Actually, why don't you introduce yourself? We're kind of going to like kick things off here and then fade away.
Thank you. Thanks, Natty. My name is Matt Blumstead with Springtime Ventures. We are a pre-seed and seed stage fund. We have people here in Colorado, Austin, Texas, and Atlanta, Georgia. We are thematic investors, so we look to invest in health tech, logistics and supply chain software, and fintech as well. 500K first checks, and you can find us at springtimeventures.com.
Sure. This one. Hi, everybody. I'm Kira Nittleman. I'm a partner at a pre-seed focus firm called B Partners. We are located both here in Denver, which is where I live for 2 years now, and also in San Francisco. We focus on a lot of deep tech, personally, a lot of synthetic biology, future food, robotics, and we have a partnership model where we're really hands-on with the teams we invest in.
Hi, everyone. I'm Megan Guy. I'm a co-founder and a GP at King River Capital. King River has about $500 million under management. We invest Series A and later, primarily in software businesses, very broadly defined. We focus on primarily North America and Australia and New Zealand, but we also have a digital asset fund focused on the crypto space, and that invests at any stage globally. So very happy to be here. Thanks for having us.
And hey, everybody, I'm Kirsten Suddeth, a general partner with Next Frontier Capital. My firm is based in Bozeman, Montana. I am here in the Colorado market in Boulder. And our firm is a Rockies-focused firm, so we invest in companies up and down the Rocky Mountains. We do kind of later seed, generally post-revenue companies through kind of later Series A. B2B businesses, we're not doing healthcare, but otherwise we're very open, about 60-70% software. We also do some deep tech and other sort of hardware investing as well.
All right, Adam is also here as the three of us are sort of co-hosting VC Day, so we're just gonna kick this session off and then, like I said, fade away. Adam, do you wanna introduce yourself real quickly?
Adam Burrows, co-founder, partner at Range Ventures. We're a fund investing in pre-seed and seed, focused on Colorado companies. Look forward to meeting all of you.
All right, so this is mostly about getting your questions answered, but sometimes the audience needs a few minutes to think of what comes to mind. So we're gonna kick off with two questions to start. The first is, what companies should not raise venture capital? We're gonna talk a lot about VC, but in your experience, who and what companies should not raise venture capital?
Yeah, I'm happy to kick off. So actually, Natty, you and I talked about this a little bit in the spring at Boulder Startup Week. And you know what we talked about was scale, right? So as you think about your business and the level of scale that you want to achieve with your company, you know, a good rule of thumb if you're out at pre-seed seed is to think about, can your company grow to $100 million in revenue? And every company's going to be different. Maybe that number is slightly different. But just think, you know, that's a big number when you're just starting out, thinking about how does your business work at that level of scale? And is that the ambition as a founder that you want to have? Like, that's a good just kind of first test.
I'm happy to just build on that a little bit. I think we ask the same question, and kind of from the investor's perspective, it's like, what do I need to believe about the world, this team, what they've built, in order to be confident that they could be a $100 million business within, like, you know, 5 years? So that's the other piece to it. I think that's really important, is the pace at which, when you take venture money, you know, you need to be growing and hitting those milestones so that you can keep raising subsequent rounds. And I'd just say, like, most companies actually shouldn't raise venture funding, in my view. If you've got other options, you know, there are a ton of different types of capital out there, and this is not the right fit for you know, the vast majority of small businesses out there.
And to build on that even further, I would argue, as an exercise, you want to, if you're trying to consider venture versus not, I mean, are you going to be able to capture $1 billion in market share over 10 years? And she just said 100 million, but, you know, your odds of success are so low that we even stack that even higher and say, okay, you know, take a haircut off that. And also, are you ready to literally pour gas on your business and light a match? So just how fast are you wanting to move? And I'd say the other point is when you get VC investment, you've got a set of overlords that are working and partnering with you, and not that, you know, it can be a very positive collaborative relationship, but to the point on ambition, is that how you want to build your business?
And I'll add one final thing, which is if you sort of say, okay, yes, I think all of these things make sense for my company, the final thing is wanting to have an exit at some point, right? At some point, your investors are going to want to get their money out, and, you know, hopefully that's a big win. But, you know, that could look like selling your company. It could look like, you know, going through the public market process, lots of different options. But that's also what your investors are going to want. You know, we mentioned the time period. Most VC funds are 10 years. There's some new interesting structures out there that change that. But, you know, just having that in the back of your mind, is this a company that I want to monetize in that time frame?
Great answers. Second question, what does it mean to you all for a founder in a company to be ready for a pre-seed round, a seed round, and a Series A round?
Yeah, I'm happy to start given my pre-seed focus. And for us, it's a lot about at the pre-seed, a team and a dream. And so really often it's pre-product, pre-revenue, pre-product market fit. It's really, really, really early. And so much of that underwriting is this the right person to be solving this problem? We talk about a concept called problem founder fit. You know, was this person really, you know, kind of like made to solve this problem? And another piece that's so important, given that almost nothing is built at the pre-seed, is just how well you understand your market and your customer and that kind of research you've done to that extent. So, yeah, leave it there.
Yeah, I'll talk about seed. This is actually a really hard, I think, question to answer because it moves a little bit with the markets and it's a little bit, you know, investor dependent. And so I think in general, advice that I give to founders looking to raise seed, Series A, kind of where we play is to go in early in your process, see who you can talk to in a very friendly way, because it's going to be dependent on what kind of business. Like if you come to me and say, I'm a consumer business, what do I need to look like to raise a seed? I'm going to tell you, I don't know because I don't invest in those companies, right? So thinking about what it is that your business does, who are the investors that, you know, that might invest there, and going to them and getting some advice. Like what are you seeing in the market today? What do you guys look for specifically, not early stage, right? Like, do you have a revenue threshold? Do you have certain, you know, team things that you want to see? And getting that advice specific to your business. In general today, what we look for, and again, I'm more at kind of later in the seed process, we look for kind of at least $500,000 in annual revenue, and we're doing rounds where we write checks $2 to $3 million or more. So these are slightly bigger rounds. And then other than that, we're looking for all the same things, you know, that Kara mentioned.
And I'll do Series A. So for Series A, we are looking, I would say, for very clear evidence of traction. Most of the time, that will look like revenue, probably $1 million plus for most of the companies that we back. Sometimes that's different, though. It could be, like, very, very intense engagement and, like, really clear evidence that your product has traction if it's sort of a product-led growth type business. But I'd say more often than not, we're looking at revenue as kind of the key driver of traction. And then I think the other thing that is really important to me when I'm looking at whether I want to invest in something at Series A is, you know, you've kind of been through a fair amount usually as a founder at that point. The company, you know, has been around a couple years. You've probably had some missteps. What have you learned? Like, show me you've got judgment and show me that you've taken all those lessons on board. You know, I think it's easy when you're very early in the journey to just, you know, you're pitching an idea more than almost anything else, right? And a bit about your experience. By the time you get to A, like, we believe in the idea. If we're taking the meeting and, you know, we're digging in deeper, we really want to understand, you know, is this a team that's going to be able to work through, you know, the later innings kind of this and get to that, you know, $100 million plus revenue run rate that we've talked about? Can they learn? Can they adapt? You know, can you hire and fire? Do you know what your weaknesses are? If you pitch me sort of just everything is great and we've never hit a speed bump and my initial idea was like spot on because I'm so smart, you don't gain a lot of credibility. So
I just want to highlight, because we're talking about revenue versus pre-seed when there's none. And so there's a, I have an added sensitivity to market size. And part of that's because at the pre-seed, you know, maybe you're 10, even 12 years from exit. And so, for example, one of our companies pivoted 14 times before exit. So you have to be in the right market for that type of pivoting to actually end up working out.
So we talked a little bit about how you decide whether you're actually going to go down the path of taking venture funding. How do you decide when to go raise money? Do you have to go through this pre-seed, seed, A cadence, or are there other different paths?
Yeah, I think that's highly dependent on the business. There's certainly, like at our stage, and I imagine yours, companies that come to us that have not raised prior capital, that have bootstrapped, and we, you know, look at those companies as well, and then the question becomes, with the additional capital, does that really speed up the growth, right? Let's see.
You know, in terms of raising money, the alternative too is an accelerator, so maybe you're not quite ready to take capital from VCs, and you maybe want community and accountability and a program to sort of learn more about business building before you start. So I would say that's another way to go. As a pre-seed investor, I know a lot of, you know, angels that I engage with who have written small checks, and so that's a, even before VC, you know, maybe you raise some angel money with people with really deep domain expertise in whatever you're building. So I think, you know, and for example, something at the pre-seed we get excited about is, hey, maybe we'll give you $1 million and it's your pre-seed, and instead of going to the seed for the next round, we think it's awesome when you, you know, when you can, to skip to the A, which means you're completely skipping the seed round.
Yeah, the only other thing I would add is be mindful of timing. Not a great idea to go raise when you've only got a couple months of cash in the bank. You lose a lot of your leverage there. You know, ideally, you want to have a competitive process and be able to talk with a lot of VCs to get the best fit for you. And so that's one mistake that sometimes we see founders make. And then I just also say be aware of sort of the market dynamics. I mean, the last quarter was a terrible time to try and raise money from venture capitalists, particularly if you were a later stage business. Everyone was a little bit frozen, I think, with the economic uncertainty and kind of a repricing in the macro space and interest rates rising. So, you know, sometimes you don't have a choice, but I would say, you know, try and time. If you can time the market, that's great.
I think we're ready to move to questions from the audience here. So I think the awesome staff from Denver Startup Week is gonna run that process here. So raise your hand, and I think the three of us are gonna fade on back. So thank you all for being here.
Thanks for having us, guys.
I'm noticing more and more companies providing debt to startups. What's your opinion on that as an alternative option, and also how do you look as a VC to debt, and how does it influence the structure of your investment?
I'm happy to take that. I think it's probably becomes increasingly more applicable to later stage companies. So most of our companies, I would say, raise venture debt shortly after they raise their round. To the extent you're able, it's a really nice option to have, and it's become a much broader market than it was even 10 years ago. There are a lot of providers out there. You know, like with any form of capital, you need to understand what you're getting into. You need to read the terms very closely, and you need to understand what sorts of choices that may make you, it may either close off or open up to you at various points, but that's not something that we look negatively upon. In fact, I'd say at the moment in particular, like, we're really encouraging it for companies because, again, we don't know what the macro environment's going to look like, and it's nice optionality to have.
Yeah, and just a little more tactical on that too. There's generally two different timings for venture debt. You can get it when you raise your equity round, and the terms on that are generally more favorable to the founders. And usually, rule of thumb, you can think about getting about a third of the round size is what I see. And that does allow you to potentially extend runway, which is a really nice feature to have when you're in these stages. There's also venture debt available in between rounds for companies that need to extend runway. That is harder to get, and it's much more expensive in terms of the interest rate on the debt for obvious reasons, right? They're coming in order to extend runway, believing that you're going to have an equity round later that can repay that debt. And so just be mindful of the timing. When you're going out to do an equity round is the best time to do it. And then there's a third type of debt, which is revenue-based investment, revenue-based financing. I would say that is great if you don't want to go the VC route. It's an amazing way to get a little bit of capital up front to do some product building or whatever you need to get into revenue. And it's a little bit trickier for venture capitalists to come in and look at that because obviously we want all of the revenue that you earn going back into growth. And so if there's a debt provider that's taking some of that, we'll usually, if that's in place, want to pay that off if we could.
Quick comments would be, we never see venture debt. Like our advice would be, you know, Series A and beyond to think about it. And usually the requirements, you know, just objectively of what they're looking for in the business or $1 million in revenue, stable customers, certain things that you just can't get it earlier. But it's great where we like to see it, the non-dilutive capital is for CapEx, certain, you know, especially those kinds of assets.
Hi. Is this on? Okay. The question is about investing in the Web3 and blockchain space. Can you talk about what you look for and maybe the approach towards investing in like a traditional corporation in the space versus maybe a DAO? And then perhaps how tokens would work and if that's something it's important or less important for you.
We haven't invested in a DAO,
but we've done quite a bit. We've done a couple of blockchain crypto deals in our kind of core fund, and now we have this digital asset fund. And we raised that in part because we were actually seeing really interesting token opportunities that we couldn't hold in our existing fund just because of the way it was structured. So for us, I'd say we really like that flexibility. I think companies have really liked that we're longer term capital than some of the hedge funds and you know folks that are just interested in the tokens and the liquid piece of the business. But we can do tokens and equity. I'd say on the equity side, we're looking for similar things as we would be making an equity investment on venture. It's a little different, obviously, because it's just the way like the network effects and momentum builds in that space. It's less, you know, revenue. It's probably another one where I'd say that traction word is kind of what we look to see. And then, you know, if there's the ability to do, you know, a token offering or some sort of a token warrant, if it's an earlier company, that's something that we definitely also look at. So, happy to chat more offline.
Just to add, we also amended our like LPA agreement to be able to invest in tokens. And the way we will invest is that if we're going to be, and there's something called a SAF, so you guys have heard of SAFEs, but this same idea, but it's for a future token amount versus equity. And the only way we'll invest in a token these days, it's been 5 years since blockchain's really been a hit, is if we'll have an arrangement where whatever maybe token amount we're buying also translates to equity, where we'll have exposure to both, where if you're, you know, years back at early days, it was a lot about the token, and then I think a lot of investors ended up realizing they had bad investments, and it didn't really work out.
Well, one just quick thing I'd add is, as a founder in that space, I think you're in a great seat because it is still very emergent in terms of like the structures, you know, the minimums, the way people are thinking about it. We see deals all over the map in terms of the way they're structuring the token offerings and this and that. And so I'd say when you start having meetings with investors, kind of know from the outset like what looks good for you and what are you steering towards? Because I think you have a lot more flexibility given this is still a newer space for a lot of funds than you do maybe on the equity side that's much more established.
Hi. another question about kind of appetite for investing. In general, is there a concern or a different level of concern when you think about investing in companies that provide services versus technology or products that we should know about?
Yes. At least for me and B Partners, we will not invest in service businesses. And it's all about scale, what we were getting into before of just the idea if humans, and I talked about human and machine interaction, but kind of like if humans are driving all of the value through services, then you're not taking advantage of the technology. Like, they should work together, but if it's purely services, we're looking for at least productized services, something that can be a platform, something that has sort of like nonlinear kind of exponential gains. So, you know, services is sort of like a trigger word.
I wouldn't say it's a trigger word for us, but I think the concern is the same, which is still, how do you get venture-like returns out of a services business? And there are plenty of companies that do, right? They create, you know, software that enables that service to be scaled, or they've got, you know, the ability to start using AI and building out parts of that to be fulfilled by machines rather than humans. But I think be aware, sort of, as you start fundraising, those are the questions like you'll get from a lot of investors. So having sort of a plan for how that's going to deliver venture returns without you just having to hire more and more and more people is key.
Yeah, and just to kind of put some maybe terminology there. You know, there's a pure services business, which is probably not a venture business. Then there's a tech-enabled services business. You know, I've seen a lot more in the sort of cyberspace using this kind of business model and some other industries as well. I think that's kind of borderline. I think you're going to find some funds that are willing to understand that better. And I think you're going to find a lot of funds that just kind of say no right at the door. And then I think there's businesses that was kind of what you were leading to that are really technology businesses that have a services component. And that could be, you know, look at like a Salesforce, right? Think about how complex Salesforce is to use. It's created this whole ecosystem around it of services companies that Salesforce doesn't manage, but they train, right? So that's one way it could go. Another way it could go is you keep those services in-house, you know, but like you were saying, you know, technology helps solve some of the human functions initially. We have a company like this that's an AI-focused company. It started off, they needed to solve all the problems with people, right? And then they learned from doing that a lot of times how they could bring technology in to decrease that load over time so that the venture capitalists understand how that business is, you know, can scale more long-term.
I'm going to throw in one other terminology, which is talk about tech-enabled services, services-enabled tech. So sometimes what I'll see is you have to gather a minimum viable data set. And so that has to be, you know, services-oriented, human, as slow as it might be for any full cycle. And that's actually really compelling with that approach.
Do businesses that have crowdfunded a round of capital impact your appetite to invest?
Not for us.
I would say for us, depends a lot on the structure. We looked at one business we really, really liked, and the way they had done their crowdfunding just created a lot of problems sort of for future rounds. So I'd say if you're gonna crowdfund, you know, work with a good lawyer and make sure you really understand what the implications will be down the road. But on principle, like, no, that wouldn't be an issue for us.
I think it matters to me why you did it. And for example, if you're a consumer business or product and and it's social proof, then that's exciting and a good reason to do it. The crowdfunding that I've seen, like Republic, is pretty dilutive capital. So it just depends.
Hello. Hello, team. My name is Rory Kuyer. I'm with the medtech startup Moonshot out of medical. Anschutz Medical Campus. I'd like to step back for a moment and ask you, kind of a question about your pedigree probe. In the sense, did you ladies begin as through the SBA program? Did you go to G School? Did you advance to the trout tanks through the local chamber of commerces? Then you know, step into the, you know, the A-listers of Series A and aspire to Shark Tank type of aspirations. If you can, is any of this Orwellian in a sense?
I don't know about Orwellian, but I would say, you know, there are things about my background that are pretty common in VC, and there are things that are pretty unusual. I spent 5 years working in the nonprofit sector doing conservation work, and actually probably some of the most relevant work I've done to working with startups. You think it's hard, you know, running a business from scratch as a startup, try doing it when like all your funding is designated for very, very specific things. So I don't think there's like any one path to VC, but certainly some that are more common than others.
Yeah, I think traditionally people would think about bankers and consultants as being the ones that jump into VC. I worked in software product management. I think you start to see that background a little bit more these days. I also transitioned into VC through going to business school. So I think that is a little bit more common. But to Megan's point, I think anyone in venture is very unique because it's like there's not one set path. That's like the most commonality that we probably all have.
And personally, I started my career as a founder. First company is bootstrapped. We were recycling used cooking oil as a feedstock for biodiesel, basically pulling trucks up to the alley and taking out really gross stuff, getting our hands dirty on trucks. Next one, we started a local food distribution company, operated for 2 years, had a spectacularly failed ending, and didn't take venture for that either, and then went to two other companies that were venture-backed. So I have experience kind of doing both, but came up on the entrepreneur and operator side.
I've got 40 years in the private equity world. Woke up one morning and decided, well, we'll invest in a startup, still checking my sanity. But we've got a company that is socially conscious. We're up and operating. And in the private equity world, the fourth quarter can actually be a very good time to raise capital because they have to deploy or they have to turn that capital over. What's happening in the VC world? Do you, I don't know what happens in the fourth quarter. If you have capital, you draw the capital when you need it. What do you see happening in the fourth quarter?
This is probably dynamic by fund, but I do think my general sense is people to kind of start winding down for the year. Like, we probably will not write a first check after Halloween. You know, November, December, there's just a lot of reporting we have to do. There's a lot of board meetings. It's just a lot of things stack up at the end of the year. And for VC, you know, our deploy cycle is over 3 years. So, zero requirement toward the end of the year. And I would never tell, I would tell a founder, you know, I wouldn't start a fundraise in October and beyond.
In 2020, I did one deal that closed the day before Thanksgiving and one that closed the Monday after. So we definitely write checks, you know, throughout the year. I think the bigger issue for us is kind of what you alluded to, which is, you know, where is each, and this is important for people raising to know, is where is each fund that you're talking to at in their fund life? Where are they in that kind of, most funds, it's a 3-year investment period. You know, are they at the very beginning of that, where they have a lot of capital to deploy? Are they at the end of it? If so, are they raising another fund? You know, what is that going to look like for you in a, you know, 5 or 10 year partnership? So that's kind of how we think about it. It's less, you know, tied to sort of traditional quarters and more to the fundraising cycle that we're on, which is not all that different actually from the one that companies are on.
Yeah, and we've also closed deals in the holidays. But generally those deals, you know, by the time you get to a term sheet, it might be a 6-week process, 4 to 6 week process to get to the final close where we're wiring. So, you know, those deals started earlier.
All right. You guys hear me? My name is Derek Shanahan. Good to see you guys. I work at Flow, not the Adam Neumann Company, but the infrastructure platform to raise and manage private funds. And we were lucky enough to close our Series A at the beginning of 2022, so decent timing. I guess as it pertains to two metrics, price and ownership, We get a really interesting variety of opinions on this. How do you think as early stage investors of price and ownership, and do you pay mind to it, or is it a little bit too early on to control for those?
Yeah, good question. And I think we actually use Flow to manage our LP interactions. We're very sensitive to both of those things. So on average, we'll write a million or a million and a half check, and we're trying to, you know, buy ownership to 10 to 15% of the company. So there's an associated valuation that comes with the check size. So, we're very disciplined about it. You could say the rules are meant to be broken in venture, which is also true, but we're disciplined. It's hard for us to break that model.
We're also disciplined, but at seed, later seed, we take a different approach, which is thinking about what does the next round look like for the company. You know, so we'll ask you questions like, what are the milestones to get to the next round? What are you hoping to raise in that round? Who would a great investor be for you? Because what we're really trying to understand is if we come in at, you know, this round size, this valuation, is there a meaningful uptick in valuation for the next round? And so if we price this too high, right, the problem is the next investor would come in and price it too close to where we priced it. And then it just feels like we, you know, helped a lot, but not a lot of value is created for our LPs during that time. So that's kind of how we think about it.
Yeah, I don't think we're totally different. I'm maybe a little less disciplined than you guys. But I think, we don't have requirements around ownership that we have to hit. We can be super flexible. We also do a lot of co-invest with our LPs, and so that can help us sort of scale up and down as the company needs, which we found to be super, super helpful. I've been at funds before where it was like we had to put $10 million minimum to work in every company, and like that forces the company into a set of choices, right? And the investor that maybe isn't always right. But I think it is important to think about those two as pieces of a whole puzzle, right? And to keep the long game in mind, right? Which is like you want to get to an awesome exit for yourself, for your investors. Ideally, you can do everything you can with the rounds along the way to keep people aligned. And I think pricing discipline is a really important piece of that because, you know, as folks have said, like if you raise an awesome Series A and it's priced, you know, you're one of these companies that goes and does a $100 million Series A, but then you don't hit your milestones, you're really going to have a hard time raising a B. And your investors are not going to want to bridge you, and it just gets ugly quickly. So I think smarter entrepreneurs are the ones that kind of say, I want something that's fair, that feels, you know, right for everybody, and that's going to set us up for the long term to raise all the rounds we're going to need to get to that exciting exit.
Hey, do you guys feel like Denver-based entrepreneurs, especially early-stage entrepreneurs, have enough access to capital to focus their fundraising efforts here, or do you think we need to be prepared to take the roadshow to San Francisco and New York?
Yeah, let's start with the pre-seed. I think it very much depends on stage. I'd say the pre-seed, you know, Denver a year or two ago, it was $2 billion in VC funding raised, and last year it was $6 billion, $7 billion. So it's really gone up a lot. I think the early stage market here is so exciting. It's a big part of why I'm here. That answer would change down the road, but that's how I feel about the pre-seed.
Yeah, and I think at seed, there's also in the last 5 years been this tremendous growth of seed funds in our region. I would still encourage you to go outside. You know, I think it's amazing if the investor you end up working with is local, because you're just going to get more attention from them if that's what you want as a founder. But you're going to have to go outside this ecosystem for probably the next round. You know, every once in a while you get lucky and you find an investor that's here for a Series A. But if you do, you know, make that trip, so to speak, you know, do some later stage networking too, right? See if you can get meetings at firms where you might be a little bit early, but start building those bridges, you know, while you're also building bridges with seed funds. And I would look to neighboring states too. We've got a bunch of investors here from Utah that are coming for Denver Startup Week, other surrounding states that are gonna have very similar values and gonna wanna also look at opportunities here. So also think about, you know, you have to travel, but maybe there's also funds that will travel here and look at companies.
And I'd look at the investor that you work with, if they're local, as being really important in actually helping you open those doors down the road too. That's another piece. You know, it's awesome to have a local partner, But if the local partner only has local partners, then, you know, you're constraining yourself. So I think if you can find, you know, someone who's in that local ecosystem, but that has really good connectivity into some of those other markets, that's just going to give you more options down the road.
Hi, thank you for being here. For companies who are maybe not deep tech and don't have a lot of IP, what does it look like to address defensibility, particularly at the pre-seed and seed stage? Is that something that's important? And if so, what does it look like for us to address that well?
I'm almost the absolute wrong person to ask because I really look at deep tech. But if you're not, if tech is not a core part of your defensibility, then it's probably about speed and execution. And why are you, you know, hopefully have a better strategy, but you're gonna outcompete, and which all that's about speed and the partnership. And it's to me that, okay, is this the team, product-led growth? How do I get behind that? I think it's a harder sell, basically.
So I used to be at Blackhorn Ventures before I was at Next Frontier, which invests in a lot of industrial technologies. And a lot of that is taking proven technology and bringing it to a market that, you know, hasn't been a huge adopter of technology. So like the learning from there, you know, I think can be applied to your question. It's not, you know, you don't have the IP around it. It's kind of a known thing. You're just bringing it to a new market. And that becomes both about speed and execution, but also about why you, right? Like, do you have the right, you know, relationships in that particular market where they're going to trust you, because this might be the first technology that they're adopting for this solving this particular problem, right? And I think the third piece is just if in emerging markets, just markets that are new, you know, that they look really small today, that's another way to think about it. Can you pick a really specific niche that nobody else is paying attention to right now and go capture that whole, even if it's small, that whole niche, and then leverage that into where you go next, into a much bigger market, is another way to think about defensibility. You say, hey, this is a little market, and here's why the rest of the market isn't paying attention to it, or the rest of the competitors. Here's why I am. Like, I see this unique, I have this unique point of view on it. And then from there, we have a platform, and we take it here, 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 and here.
And build something really sticky that's like very painful for a customer to rip out or switch, I think is the other thing. The more embedded you can be into like the totality of their business, or the more risk there is in them changing providers, that's a great moat that isn't necessarily reliant on technology.
Final note is network effects, right? So speed to where network effects start to take place, and then why it's sticky, yeah, or why you get this back and forth.
Yeah, thanks guys for being here. I just had a question in, you know, getting the foot in the door with investors. You know, what's your advice for people that maybe aren't as well connected, or, you know, the kind of pre-seed or seed stage, just to have conversations with investors?
As a starting point, events like this are awesome. And I think what you're trying to do to just get a foot in the door is, investors are human, so, you know, understand who they are. The firms they're at, it's pretty well outlined often, like what they're actually looking for on their website, or, you know, thesis fit. So, I mean, the closer, if you don't have an actual warm intro, like you're creating that for yourself by saying, you know, hey, here's the ways I think we have X, Y, and Z in common. And I guess another little party trick might be, if you teach somebody something new, they're, you know, so somebody teaches me something new about a space, and I'm like on the edge if I even care about that space, but they're like, hey, you need to look, and here's why, I'll take that meeting. So that's also an enterprise sales hack too, but, you know, teach the investor something.
There's also investors that are breaking down those walls, so also look for them. You know, like if you go to my LinkedIn, in my bio, there's a link to book my calendar, right? And it might be a month out, especially maybe two with Denver Startup Week, but you can just get on my calendar that way. Tons of people are doing this. Look on their Twitter, look on their LinkedIn, look on their website. Is there a way to get in touch with them without a warm introduction and breaking down those walls? I think the second piece that I would say there is you can start doing investor updates or just community stakeholder updates where you take an hour out of your month or every couple of months and you're sending, hey, here's the things that are going great for my business, and I have some asks, right? Then start building the list that you send that to. And you can have one that's just for investors, one that's for a broader group. And then in those asks saying, hey, I want to raise in 9 months, and I'd love to make some connections before that. Can I, you know, can anybody introduce me to funds that might be a good fit for me? And that's another way to just broaden your network in kind of a leveraged way that doesn't require a lot of Googling and LinkedIning.
And just to add to Kristen's point, we have a form on our website where we will look at any deal that's submitted to us, and with some updated software we've built, you know, we have a service level agreement where, you know, within a few days or a month, you'll hear from us for sure. So I think more and more VCs are definitely doing that, and like, check it out, because if they are, you should absolutely go that path.
Thanks for being here today. We appreciate your time. What are your thoughts around fractional accounting, HR, other services when you're about to raise capital? Are you comfortable with having that outsourced? Do you prefer having full-time insource?
I think it totally depends on the stage of the business. I'd say most businesses we look at before probably Series B, it's outsourced. Obviously, the quality of that firm, and like, you know, we'll do a call with them and want to understand, you know, what are the processes you have in place, like what are they focused on, where are some of the risks. So it's important they're credible in that, but that's not a negative at all for us. I mean, frankly, it's more appropriate. I think it would raise a red flag for like a pre-revenue company to have a CFO on board in some cases. But certainly over time, that becomes really important. If you have a, you know, complex like way you're selling or type of financing you're doing, or you know, the company is just into the stage where you need much more consistent reporting and you know, you're starting to get audits and things like that, then I think it makes a lot of sense to start bringing that capacity in-house. As well as if you want to do, you know, any sort of like M&A business development stuff, which I think we're going to see more of in the next year with where the market has been. I think, you know, a really good CFO or, you know, someone that's very strong on kind of financial modeling and those skills is awesome to have in-house.
Yeah, same for us. Most of our companies transition between A and B from fractional to in-house.
Hi. I have a bit of a controversial question, but it's Ask Me Anything, so I hope it's okay. And first, it's nice, really, to see three women VC on stage, not taken for granted. So do you, when you sit in your rooms and have your investment committees, do you see yourselves as gateway keepers for the businesses that will be created, and to that effect, you know, what kind of world we're going to live in? Or do you truly believe that it's a level playing field, and if there's out there a great company, no matter what VCs have access to it, it will emerge because it's good and with the right team and the right idea?
Have to go.
Yeah, I'll go next.
Okay. I was like, 100% there are structural problems. You know, there. If you just look at the $7 billion, $6.7 billion that came into the state last year, it was like 1.3% of that went to female-founded companies, for example. That doesn't happen in a market that functions properly, right? So there are structural problems. And you know, I think the way that personally I think about that is you've got to provide education. This is a tremendous event for that. You've got to provide accessibility to the networks. Again, great event for that. And I think there's a lot happening in this state, and a lot of VCs are more aware of this. How do we break down those barriers, not require warm intros, so that we're more accessible to a broader audience? And then you also need, for us as VCs, our pipeline has to represent our population. And if it's not, then we have to get into different networks, right? And so personally, when I think about one particular company, I'm playing a screen, which is like, if this company is truly huge, right, and has this amazing outcome, how does that affect the world, right? And we can't predict everything, right? But what does the world look like, and is it changed in a way that I think is better in overall. So we're not an impact-focused fund, but I still think you have to think about the businesses you're going to create and the impact they're going to have. And then I think is at the pipeline level, we have to, and we track this, we have to look at who's coming to us. And if we don't like the demographic, then it's, you know, we have to change how our network is built.
There's this interesting Harvard Business Review study, and it was something like there was a 25-point difference in exit, the amount of exit for founders, and the difference was whether for female and male when there was a one-woman VC involved versus not. And bottom line is, I do think all of it matters, but I think the part of female VCs being around the table really matters too. You know, that's one data point, but you know, there's a huge partnership that's being built in these companies, and like something we're doing, there's not an even mix of founders or VCs, but how do we at least start going in the right direction? And so, for example, when we syndicate deals, meaning we'll share the opportunity, something we did recently for Series A is offer an investment, no fee, no carry, meaning whoever we're offering it to, it's basically free for them. And we did it for female angels. And so it was like, okay, this is definitely not gonna be 50-50 of check size and women and men, but what if we got 50-50 in terms of who's around the table, in terms of the investors?
Yeah, it's not a level playing field at all. Anyone who tells you it is, I think, is living in a bit of a fantasy world. But just to get a little more tactical, like, because a lot of these are issues we need to solve at our firms and across our industry. But I think for founders, like, the partner you're working with really matters. The team you're choosing to work with really matters. And whether you're an underrepresented founder or an overrepresented founder, you can send a really powerful message about that with the meetings you take and the people whose capital you choose to accept. Now, obviously, not everyone has the ability to be choosy, but if you do, like, you know, make it known, like, ask them, like, hey, like, I was on your website, and the only women that seem to be on your site are, you know, your support staff. Like, do you guys back, like, female-led companies? You know, and you'll see pretty quickly, I think, like, if they're aware of it being a problem and they're working to change it, or if you get some, you know, BS excuse about the pipeline and, like, there not being enough candidates. So that's kind of my advice to you is, like, if you've built something great, take it to people that are going to appreciate it and see it. And make sure the ones that want in that don't see it or that don't see it with others, maybe, understand why they're not getting a bite at the apple.
And to Megan's point, I mean, we, and I helped write this page, we have a diversity, equity, and inclusion page on our website, and it shows all the stats of underrepresented, of women. You know, for example, our numbers are closer to, like, 35% female founders, which is better than average. Average is like 8%, and then it's not 50%. And I agree with Kirsten's point. It should be representative of the population. So I think that people who care, if you bring it up as a topic, will have answers for you. And I think it's a pretty easy read on who's paying attention versus not.
For a B2B SaaS company, is there any revenue or growth numbers that specifically stand out that would increase your success on raising a round? Or specific KPIs that really jump out?
Yeah, I think right now for SaaS, one that's being particularly paid attention to is like a burn multiple or sales efficiency. So one way to think about that is how much new ARR are you generating in maybe a quarter versus how much are you burning? And if it's around one, that's a great number for today because it shows you're using capital really efficiently. In the market we were in last year, it was probably more about top line growth. Were you growing at like, you know, 200%, 300% year over year? So you do have to kind of read the markets. And there's a lot of VCs that blog about this and kind of give you a sense of that. So I'd check out, I like Mark Suster's blog, Both Sides of the Table. I like Fred Wilson's blog, AVC. And you know, just if you're reading a couple of VC blogs, they're going to tell you like here's where the market is, and here are kind of the key metrics.
Yeah, I mean, I'd say pretty similar. Like, I think the focus is very much on unit economics and kind of sustainability of the business. You know, if you've sold a bunch of customers, we're interested in like what's the average contract size? Are people renewing, right? What's your net revenue retention look like? Are those contracts growing and expanding? So, you know, nothing kind of revolutionary there, but I'd say the weighting is a little bit different in terms of, yeah, thinking about burn multiple and your sales efficiency versus being much more focused on just like top line year over year growth in past years. And I also check out, like, I think Bessemer does some of the best writing on B2B SaaS out there, so I'd have a look at some of their stuff.
Yeah, so I have the challenge of working in the biotech space, and two major hurdles that we face is scale and geography. It's, you know, our seed raise is $5 to $10 million. Our Series A is $20 million to $120 million. And the about a third of the VC investment activity in bio is in the Boston area, another third in the Bay Area, about 12% in San Diego. And it tends to be very insular. It doesn't stray outside those ecosystems. The other 20% is thinly spread across the country, Chicago, here. What advice, observations do you have for the biotechs in this middle area, like Colorado, for raising funds?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think there are biotech investors out here locally. I would argue I'm a tech bio investor. And all that means is just focusing on a lot of computational data and how like you get those gains from technology around this physical and wet lab type of product. But the bottom line is, it goes back to the earlier question, which is whether you're doing it yourself or you're meeting investors. I think the easiest way, for example, to answer your question is talking to investors who have those networks that you don't. But essentially, if it's a network game, I mean, you're not wrong, right? There's centers of gravity for any one area. And it's like less about, can you find a check here? I mean, it sounds like you might have. But more like where the future rounds and capital are gonna be coming from. So, I mean, the other answer for you is just to kind of strategically, structurally understand, what is it like, life sciences angels. There's all these different groups out here that also are, could serve as nodes like investors can. But I don't think there's an easy answer. Like, for you, in terms of raising money, you gotta know the people who've got the money.
Yeah, the only other thing I'd add is you can look at non-dilutive financing. Right, so we're gonna do a panel later this evening at 5:30 on funding for clean tech and climate tech. So it's gonna be a little bit different, but we are gonna discuss other non-dilutive financing options and what's out there.
Hi, thank you. My name's Kristen Gendron. I'm with the VF Venture Foundry, the venture studio of VF Corporation. I wanted to build on the DEI question and conversation earlier. One of the things that we've identified as a differentiator in access is founder stipends and salaries. There's a major kind of difference of those who can afford to take risk for, you know, extended periods of time to bootstrap their businesses, which doesn't necessarily reflect the talent of the entrepreneur behind the business. I'm curious, though, how do you think at the later stages around founder salaries, what's appropriate, what's not appropriate? How do you think about that at the later stages in terms of compensation?
I can take a first crack. We think people should be paid for the work they do at market rates. And, you know, so I would never tell a founder that they shouldn't be taking a salary, right? That's a very personal choice. It's gonna be very unique to someone's own circumstances, and no judgment one way or another, like what gets decided. But you know, I think kind of the best practice is to set up, especially once you get into later stages and you have a board and things like that, is to set up a comp committee on the board. And so we do that with our companies. We use external survey data to look at what, you know, for companies that have raised X amount of dollars, you know, founder, CEO, or you know, whatever the executive role is, and the board actually plays a very active role in setting and approving founder comp. And I think that's the cleanest way to do it. You know, that's hopefully fair. And it gets at a lot of those issues that you're talking about.
maybe just a nuance to that is that the pre-seed, it's a little different because you're not having salary bands and all that. And I would say it's pretty dynamic, meaning if someone's got a family and kids, and this is male or female, you know, like for example, some founders, it's almost always at the start sub 100K salaries, maybe it's closer to 60K. Basically, as they get closer to a Series A, I see people get close to market rates. And then based on the founder's personal situation, we are very flexible with how much they want to pay themselves.
Hey, how's it going? I'm an early stage founder and we are considering raising. So I've just been having a lot of conversations and it seems to be very subjective at my stage. So I'm curious, what are some of the objective truths or in other words, the universal notions that from your perspective, you have to see in a founder and in the company?
We've talked about a lot of this stuff. I mean, I think, like, are you, someone asked before about, like are you going to raise money with or without me? You want an investor to feel like it's going to be either way, and, like, we'll see deals, and we'll say this is going to get funded whether we do it or not. So, I mean, that's a lot about just, like, your domain expertise, your vision, your, you know, like, I think a good founder in its in his or her essence is a resource magnet, and that's about that's raising capital, that's hiring, that's customers. So you demonstrating resource magnetism to me is the mark of a really, really strong founder.
Yeah, and I think it is really specific to your company, so happy to chat after this offline a little bit about what you're building.
The only other thing I would add is founder's super important, but so is the team. And especially at slightly later stages, kind of where we invest, we don't want a single point of failure at a company. We want to make sure that you've built out around you a group of equally committed, inspired, smart people that are going to go tackle this problem and, like you said, like build this thing one way or not. So I think that's important too. I think that was our...
That's going to be our last question here. Let's give a round of applause for this amazing panel up here. All right. So we have in about 10, 15 minutes, we're going to start our last VC session here, which is we have four coastal investors in town to tell you what does it mean to raise money on the coast outside of Colorado. What are the standards different? How can you stand out? So for anyone who's interested in raising capital, I think it's a super important one to stay for because inevitably you will be going to the coast to raise money, even if you maybe raise your seed round here locally. So encourage you to hang around. That'll start in about 10 minutes. And thank you all for being here.